Hi everyone, I'd just like to thank you for joining with us on this Good Friday, the day that we celebrate and remember the death of Jesus Christ. It was the day that he, as Paul writes, demonstrated his love for us. We're so excited we have Bob Snell with us today to share God's word with you. And I would just like to begin this time by giving thanks in prayer. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for this demonstration of your love, for paying for our sins on the cross, for giving yourself for us, and for giving to us a love that can never be separated. Even though we feel separate and we may feel apart at this time, Lord, we recognize that you have built your church invisible on the earth, that even though we're not together, we are together in spirit. And I thank you for this time, and I thank you so much for your son. We love you. Pray your blessing upon this service. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, it is good to be with you this morning, and glad that you could join us for our Good Friday service. To prepare our hearts as we begin our time in worship, let me just read to you an excerpt from Revelation chapter 7. After this, I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and people and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the creatures were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever. Amen." And then verse 17, "For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living waters, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." Let's just praise him together as we sing together, "Crown Him."
Stop my heart to hear. Hey there, FBC friends and family. I was asked to intro this next song called Scars. And I thought, oh, that's going to be really easy. But as it turns out, it's really hard for me to summarize why I chose it. So I'll do my best to make it short and sweet. The song I personally relate to. I grew up in a Christian home, in a God-fearing home, I should say. And I had a lot of knowledge about the Bible and scriptures. And over time, it became more in here than in here. And my dad used to challenge that and say, I would know you know, Tiffany, but do you know? And it wasn't too long before we learned when I was a young adult that I had more head knowledge than heart knowledge. And I had let some bitterness seep into my heart, and that kind of took over everything, and I started to make some really bad choices. And I went through some pretty dark moments, some very dark moments, and there was a pinnacle point in my life that I knew that I needed God. I didn't just know it, I knew it. And I literally, in that moment, fell to my knees, and I asked the Lord to please just help me to know what to do, what was right. It was that brokenness. And He took over, and He brought peace first and foremost. He brought forgiveness, and I have scars today. I have scars from choices that I made, but they're healed because of God's blood, because He chose to die on that cross for the sins that I would commit. And this first verse of the song talks about waking up in a new sunrise, looking back from the other side. And that's where I'm at today. I can look back on decisions that I made and things that I did, choices that I'm not proud of, the choices that leave scars, that have lasting effects. But I can just rejoice in the brokenness that came with that, and the ability to be able to say, thank you, Lord, for these scars. And now I can say that I really know His heart, His compassion towards me, His forgiveness, His love, and His mercy is unlike anything that I could ever explain. So the song starts about my personal reflection, but it goes so much deeper into the reality of His scars, and it's because of His scars and what He did on that cross that there's rejoicing and there's joy and there's truly forgiveness and is lasting peace. Anyways, I hope that summarizes it enough. It doesn't even scratch the surface. I hope that you are able to enjoy the song and have an attachment to it in a very similar way that I have an attachment to it. And if not, then just rejoice in His scars, in the healing blood, in the forgiving blood of His scars. Thanks, guys.
Darkest. want you to know that I'm very pleased to extend my own personal Easter Friday greeting to you today. When I was asked by your dear pastor a while ago if I would be willing to come and preach for this Easter Friday service, you need to know I did not hesitate for one moment to accept this kind request. I'm honored today to speak of the death of our precious Savior, who died for us a horrible death on Calvary, but rose again 3 days later from the grave. And oh, the depth of his love for a world so desperately in need of sins forgiven and eternal life. So it's wonderful to be with you as a church family today here at Fellowship Bible Church in New Hamburg. I'm grateful for the kindness of this church family to have me here and allow me to enjoy this time of fellowship with you in this way. I need you to know that I hold your pastor in very high esteem, along with his wife and 5 children. I know that Pastor Sean has been mightily used of the Lord in this place, and he has evidenced over the years here at Fellowship Bible a perseverance and a dedication to the work of God. Sometimes this kind of dedication and perseverance is lacking in our local churches, but certainly not here. And I certainly remember as well his Easter Friday message at First Baptist Church in Waterloo. I was pastoring there at the time, and as we joined together as 3 churches, my heart was tremendously blessed by the presentation of God's word that he brought to us on that Friday morning. My prayer would be for the pastor and people here at Fellowship Bible Church, I'm desirous for you as a church family that you would know the love of the Lord Jesus Christ that surpasses all understanding, and that you would be committed not only in these days, but in the weeks and years to come to just give yourselves wholeheartedly to a God who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ever ask or think. God is so good, and in spite of the days in which we live, we know that he's a faithful God, and we can fully depend upon him for all that we might feel we're in need of. I would also like to add this before we move into the presentation of God's word this morning. As Christians in Canada and around our troubled world, this Good Friday, this Easter Friday, is a historic, it's a very unusual, and yet it's a significant Easter weekend. As we move forward in our lives beyond this time, whenever that time would end, we'll look back upon this particular Easter weekend, and we will not forget that which led us up to this time as well as that which followed. And as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, we can be assured of our sure foundation. You know, the Apostle Paul would say in 1 Corinthians, "Let no one lay any other foundation than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ." So it is our precious Savior, and it is his word that we're going to have the privilege of examining for just a few moments this morning. And I trust that you will join with me as we lay our hearts upon this sure word of truth, the word of God, and the central person of this wonderful book, the Lord Jesus Christ, is the one whom we worship and we adore this morning. So I would urge you, if you have your Bibles with you, to take them and turn to the book of John chapter 19. There are 3 verses here in John 19 that I'd like to share with you this morning. I trust it'll be a blessing to your heart as we consider all that this day represents in the life of the child of God. And I've entitled this message this morning, Christ's Final Words. I knew Craig well. The time of which I speak, he was 19 years of age, an exceptional 3-star sport athlete. He was a young man who was an honors student in school in Guelph, a very solid believer. For someone that young, he showed tremendous maturity in his walk with his Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And I remember the day that I traveled from Waterloo down to Princess Margaret Hospital in Toronto. Months earlier, Craig had been diagnosed with leukemia. And on that day, I went to his ward room, and there were two ladies present there in the room when I arrived. I introduced myself to both of them. They introduced themselves to me. One of them was his attendant nurse, and the second lady was another leukemia patient. I knew neither lady, but this other lady who was a leukemia patient, she was a young high school teacher, single lady, and she was there, of course, for treatment along with Craig. The nurse needed some time alone with Craig, and so she asked if we would just step out of the room for a few moments and go down to the visitation room, which we did. And so with this high school teacher, young lady, accompanying me, we went to the room and we sat down and we began to share back and forth. I asked her about her physical condition, and she shared a little bit about her life and her background and what had transpired in previous months to bring her to Princess Margaret Hospital. And then I remember I asked her regarding Craig's physical condition. And actually, she didn't reply regarding his physical condition, but she spoke and she replied concerning his spiritual condition by saying this, and I quote, "Craig has such a strong faith in the Lord, of which I'm envious." And even to this very day, I remember those poignant words and the way in which God used those words to stir my heart concerning her spiritual condition and what that might be. I knew that she was envious of his faith, and so we began to speak concerning issues like life and death and eternity. And of course, what was interesting and understandable in light of what I knew about Craig was Craig had already shared, obviously, about his faith and trust, not in a church, in a denomination, but his faith and trust in his Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so I had the privilege of once again sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ with her. I wish I could tell you today that she responded in repentance toward God and faith toward the Lord Jesus Christ that day, but she did not. And I never met her again, and I'm not sure where she is today. Only the Lord really knows. 3 weeks later, I was in my office, a church office, and I picked up the telephone and I made a call to Craig's room at Princess Margaret. And I said to Craig, I said, "How are things in your life?" And I heard him speak the final words that I'd ever hear him utter. And he said primarily two things. Number one, he said, "My blood count is low. I'm weak. I don't think if pneumonia comes that I'll ever be able to fight it off." And Craig was prophetic, for it was 3 days later that he was ushered out into eternity to be with his precious Savior in heaven. And he went out into eternity because of pneumonia. That was his physical condition. But then he responded this way to me when I asked him this question that day. I said, "Craig, if the Lord doesn't preserve your life, what is it that you would like me to share with others in the future about your life?" And these final words from his lips were this: "Tell them that it pays to live for Jesus Christ. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain." We're talking about final words. Final words. Are final words memorable? Are they significant? Well, many times they are. Certainly, Christ's final words were significant. They were of eternal worth and value as he died on Calvary's cross. Craig's last words addressed his physical condition, but more importantly, his eternal and his spiritual condition. For the Lord Jesus Christ, in the two final words that I'm going to share with you this morning from John chapter 19 that he spoke just prior to his dying, him giving up his spirit, one of these words speaks to the issue of his physical agony on Calvary. But the other final word relates to the issue of eternity, the most critical issue that faces mankind. And so in John 19, verses 28 to 30, if you look at it in your passage of scripture, we're provided in these three verses the last two words uttered by Jesus prior to his death. I'd like you to notice, first of all, this morning, his last words addressed a physical need, a physical need. And here's what we read in verse number 28. After this, after what? Well, after Jesus had spoken to the apostle John and also his mother in all of his agony and pain on Calvary, he was able to look down and speak to his mom and speak to the apostle John. And it says, after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, now notice, that the scripture might be fulfilled, he said, I thirst. Now there was set a vessel full of vinegar. They filled a sponge with vinegar. They put it upon hyssop, and they put it to his mouth. His last word addressed a physical need, and the physical need was simply this. He says, I thirst. I thirst. Actually, in the language of Christ's day, it is only one word. In our English language, I thirst is two words, or if you say I am thirsty, it's three words. But in his language, it was just one word, and it's the word dipsao. And he says, I'm thirsty, I thirst. And we're told here that this statement fulfilled a millennium, a 1,000-year-old prophecy. For if you go back to Psalm 69 and verse number 3 and verse number 21, in that great psalm, the psalmist says in verse 3, my throat is dried. And then a little later in verse 21, he says, in my thirst they gave me vinegar, which they did. And you'll read of this in verse number 29, they put it on a hyssop stick and they put it up to his lips and he tasted that vinegar. If you think back to the great messianic psalm, Psalm 22, and in verse number 15, it's prophetic of the Messiah. For we're told there that the psalmist says, my tongue cleaves to my jaw. And that would speak of the agony of thirst that Christ experienced on Calvary's cross. You know, there's a key claim by the Lord Jesus Christ that we learn of when you come to John chapter 4. It's the account of the woman at the well in Samaria. And of course, Jesus, knowing the end from the beginning, comes to this well. He knows that he would encounter a lady who had been married a number of times, and she'd been living presently with a man. He knew all that, and he would eventually engage her in a conversation having to do with her sin and her need of repentance. But before that even transpired, we learn of this, that Jesus has water that is drawn from that well, and there's quite a conversation that goes on between the Lord Jesus and this woman of Samaria. Eventually, the disciples, whom he had sent away to go get some groceries in a neighboring town, they come back and they have some food for him and they say, Master, eat. And he says to them, he says, I have food to eat that you don't even know about. He says, that meat, what really fills me up is to do the will of my Father which is in heaven and to finish his work. You say, well, Pastor Snell, why do you address the issue of Christ's claim here of what his real purpose for coming to this world was all about? How does that relate to his thirst? Well, when you read this passage of scripture of John 19, you'll find that this statement, I thirst, fulfilled this millennial old prophecy. And for all those hundreds of years, that prophecy was not fulfilled until that day on Good Friday when Christ spoke that as one of his last words. And I ask you this morning, I'm wondering if you're fulfilling the purpose that God has for your life. One of my favorite verses is Philippians 1:6, where it says, being confident of this very thing, that he which has begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. That day of Jesus Christ relates either to the moment when we die and are ushered into his presence, or the day that Jesus Christ comes back to receive us to be with himself forever and forever. And so the real question on this Easter Friday is this: are you fulfilling the purpose that God had for you when he wonderfully saved you by his grace and brought you into this most wonderful of all families, the family of God, giving to you eternal life? There's a job to be done. There's a purpose to be fulfilled. And the Lord Jesus Christ fulfilled prophecy on this particular day. What about this thirst? Well, in part, it revealed the extent of Christ's Calvary agony. Ancient historians claimed almost unanimously that thirst was one of the chief agonies of crucifixion. In fact, one writer said, and I quote, of all the physical agonies coming to the human body as death arrives or approaches, thirst is terrible beyond the power of words to describe. I'm sure your pastor would agree with me and any who have ever visited in a hospital, and especially with someone who's near to death's door. I've been there on numerous occasions. Happy to be there, not to see the event unfold, but to spend time with that one. Usually they're a child of God, ready to go home to be with their precious Savior. I'm glad to be there to help the family and help the one who will soon be deceased. And more often than not, you'll find on the table beside the bed, there'll be a cup. There'll be a straw in that cup and there'll be water. And usually that water is still cool because the nurses will try to bring cool water. And one of the things that a person near to death will tend to want is a cool sip of water. Oh, the agony of thirst accompanying death. Couldn't help but think of the rich man. Luke 16, Jesus speaks of him. He's in torments in a place called Hades. We understand it to be hell. And he cries out, being in torments. And he says, Father Abraham, I would beg of you that you would send Lazarus the beggar, that he might dip the tip of his finger in water and come with that water and cool my tongue, for I'm tormented in this flame. For the Christ rejecting sinner, a moment, the first moment in hellfire is only the moment of an eternity without the Savior, but an eternity of horrendous pain and agony, and the need to have one's tongue soothed with cool water. But it will not happen. Oh, if you're here today without Jesus Christ, on this Good Friday, it can be a Good Friday for you if you come to this one who is the everlasting water of life. Jesus would say to this woman at the well, this water, you drink of it, you're going to thirst again. But the water that I give is a water that will spring up unto eternal life. What he was saying was this, you need me. I'm the water of life. I'm the only one who can ever eternally quench your thirst. Dr. Warren Wiersbe, a number of years ago, spoke of being in a restaurant with a pastor friend of his. And of course, you know, when you go to a restaurant, the waitress or the waiter will oftentimes come, and the first question that they'll ask is simply this, gentlemen or family, whoever you're with, would you like anything from the bar? And so Dr. Wiersbe, being with his pastor friend, heard this waitress ask, is there anything, gentlemen, you would like from the bar? We're told that Wiersbe's friend kindly but calmly replied, and I quote, honey, over 20 years ago, I took a drink, and I haven't been thirsty since, end of quote. He went on that day and shared with her concerning the water of life, the Lord Jesus Christ, and how she needed Christ as her personal Lord and Savior. I'm reminded right in the last chapter of Revelation, the book of Revelation, chapter 22, Jesus says, I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify to you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright and morning star. Now listen to this. And the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. I'm here today to remind you that the water of life is a free gift. The gift of God is eternal life, and it's a free gift, but you must be willing to come, repent of your sin, and believe in Jesus who died for your sins personally on Calvary, and receive him into your life to be your everlasting Savior. And so we have here, first of all, this morning, the reminder that Christ's last words addressed a physical need. I thirst. But I want you to notice finally this morning, his last words addressed mankind's eternal, their spiritual need. For in verse number 30 of our text, we read these words. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. It's interesting that this expression as well is truly only one word, just like I thirst was one word in the language that Christ spoke. So this phrase that we have as three words in our English language, it is finished, is actually just one word in Christ's language. And it is the word tetelestai, and it refers to that which is consummated, that which is completed, that which is fulfilled, that which is done. In this context, it's not an expression of defeat, but clearly and completely it's an expression from the cross of Calvary by our Savior, which is filled with triumph and victory. Before we touch upon this, remember that Christ didn't cry with the eight-letter first-person singular expression that sounds a lot like tetelestai, that word which is in the first person singular is teteleka. And if it was that word, it would mean, I am finished. I am finished. But it was in the third person singular. And it is a 10-letter word. Not an 8-letter, but a 10-letter word. Tetelestai. And it means, it is finished. And so the question that comes my way and your way this morning is simply this. What was completed? What was done? Well, very simply, there are two things that were completed, I believe. Number one, we have the completion of Christ's crucifixion, agony, and horror, and pain. If you take all of the gospel writers, this is a great exercise on Easter weekend. Just take all of the gospel writers, go to, you know, one of the last couple chapters of each of the gospels, and just read through all that characterized crucifixion. It was a horrendous death that an individual experienced on a cross. It was the Roman form of punishment at that time. And when you read through all of the details, you'll find that most of them relate to the physical pain that was experienced by the person on that cross. But we also need to be reminded today of the words of Jesus Christ when he said, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which being interpreted is this, my God, why have you forsaken me? And of course, the Savior was forsaken for those 6 long hours on Calvary in order that we might not be forsaken for an eternity. There's nothing worse in all the world for a person to ever than for a person to go out into a Christless eternity, to be forever separated from the Savior, and to spend an eternity in the lake of fire. The completion of Christ's crucifixion, the greatest thing that happened that day, finally, was that it was all over. It was completed. It was done. Christ was no longer ever to suffer again. And so we have the completion of his crucifixion, pain and agony. But finally, and I think most importantly, as it relates to this phrase, it is finished. The completion of the Father's salvation plan for lost humanity. You know, in Hebrews chapter 9, the writer there would say this in verse number 26, that Jesus once appeared at the end of the world, probably speaking at that dispensation of time, that he once appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. He was once offered to bear the sins of many. And then it concludes this way. It's appointed unto man once to die, and after this, the judgment. If you go to chapter 10 and verse number 14, we're told that the Father has perfected forever those who are sanctified. And there was one offering for sin that was made on Calvary's cross. And it was the only place that sin could be paid for, because it was the Father's divine plan and purpose to make that available for every poor lost sinner. In Christ's day, merchants would use this word tetelestai. The buyer would purchase an item, and once the currency was received and the payment made, the merchant would proclaim, tetelestai, meaning the transaction was completed, the debt was fully paid. Christ paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt because of my sin I could not pay. I needed someone to wash my sin away. But now I sing a brand new song, Amazing Grace. Christ Jesus paid the debt that I could never pay. I came to the Savior one day as a young boy, knelt by my living room couch, knowing full well that I was a sinner on my way to hell. Having heard the gospel message over and over again, I finally repented of my sin and trusted the Savior. He paid my debt, a debt that I could never pay, a debt that you can never pay. That debt was completed when Jesus said, "It is finished." And then he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. On Calvary, sin's wages were paid in full. The redemption needed to secure forgiveness of sin and eternal salvation was a done deal. Some years ago, and with this I conclude, there was an evangelist whose name was Alexander Wooten. A man came to him one day and said rather sarcastically, "What must I do to be saved?" Knowing the man was not serious, Wooten replied, "It's too late. It's too late." The man became alarmed. He said, "No, no, what must I do to be saved?" And Wooten said, "It's too late. It's already been done. And it has already been done. But like anything relating to a gift does not become mine unless I receive it. And you must receive the debt that Christ paid for your sin on Calvary's cross. You can do that today. In the midst of this COVID-19 epidemic that has swept across our entire globe, one that we would have never, ever dreamed possible, on this Good Friday, it can become the greatest day of your life in the midst of all of the turmoil and trouble in this world, if you would but be willing to acknowledge that you're a sinner, that Jesus died for you, and give your life to him, a life that is eternal life. Jesus would say, "I thirst," but he would also say, "It is finished." And then 3 days later, we know that he was not finished. God's plan was finished for salvation. But 3 days later, he rose victoriously from the dead, indicating his power over death and the grave. Would you come to Christ this morning? And if you are a child of God and you have been saved, would you give your life afresh on this Easter Friday to serve the Lord in the future with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength? I trust you will. Let's pray together, shall we? Lord, what a blessing it is to gather together on this Easter Friday, a rather unusual kind of circumstance that surrounds us. And yet, Lord, we know that you are present with us, that you ever live to make intercession for us. And I believe, Lord, that you have been praying for all those within the sound of my voice, knowing that all of us have needs. Some have a need to be saved. Oh Lord, bring them to conversion today. And if we're a child of God, we know that we have a need to follow you and to live wholeheartedly for you every day of our life, now and into the future. Oh Lord, may this be a day of decision in all of our lives. And we give you the praise, honor, and the glory, thanking you for this time together. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you very much for this wonderful privilege of gathering with you today, and may the Lord greatly bless you, especially as a church family here in New Hamburg. May God mightily use your ministry to honor the honor and glory of his name.